Gildan Media presents Your Coach in a Box, affordable, life-changing audio programs. Gildan Media presents an unabridged recording of Be Your Best Boss. Reinvent Yourself from Employee to Entrepreneur by William R. Seagraves. Narrated by Sean Pratt. Large impersonal institutions confer degrees without wisdom. Infomercials and seminars offer coaching that all too often is little more than a DVD set and more sales pitches. Bill Seagraves and his wife Teresa are a refreshing exception to that sad norm. The irony is, Bill's business of enabling entrepreneurs to self-fund their businesses in no way requires that they be. Bill could just as well operate like an attorney, rubber-stamping transactions, dotting I's, crossing T's, and forwarding paperwork. Instead, Bill brings a huge added value to his financing expertise. He doesn't let his clients buy businesses they don't belong in, and he ensures that they embark on the entrepreneurial journey with eyes, ears, and sixth sense wide open. Having coached thousands of entrepreneurs myself, as a Google AdWords consultant, I can assure you this kind of mentoring is sorely needed. Bill won't let you become his client unless you're truly qualified. He stands in contrast with thousands of biz-op salesmen whose only criteria for taking your money is that you have some to take. That is why I'm recommending this book to you. It will take you on a journey, not only of business discovery, but also of self-discovery. Bill will explain not only the mechanics of funding your own enterprise, but also how to adopt the mindset and mental toughness that business in the 21st century requires. And one last word. Just like the jungle is not for domesticated pets, the entrepreneurial path is not for everyone. Many would-be entrepreneurs are merely armchair quarterbacks living their dreams vicariously through others. They read or listen to self-help books and dream of manifesting their personal greatness, but never actually do it. Others start their journey with gusto and come back in body bags. Bill Seagraves is worthy of being your advisor. Listen to this book and find out if the entrepreneur's journey is truly for you. Perry Marshall, Chicago, Illinois. Perry Marshall is the best-selling author of Ultimate Guide to Google AdWords, Ultimate Guide to Facebook Advertising, and 80-20 Sales and Marketing. Introduction. I always want to drive. Everyone else is welcome to be my passenger. Even if it's just for a jaunt across town with a client or business colleague, I'm the one who whips out my car keys before anyone else can. It's always been that way. Ever since I got my driver's license, I've found a way to be the driver whenever I can. Group going to a party? I happily designate myself the sober chauffeur. Family trip and my wife offers to drive? I insist that she relax and enjoy the sights. Even considering the hundreds of micro decisions and the risk and responsibility inherent in driving, I prefer it over being a passive passenger. Until I began writing this book, I didn't realize how much this preference carries over to my business personality. When I used to work for other people, I was at the whim of their decisions. Even if I saw a potentially better road to take, I couldn't go there unless my boss condoned it. My employer's hands were on the wheel, not mine. I liked corporate life in many ways, but I could not stand this lack of control. So, in 1995, I stopped being someone's employee and became an entrepreneur, which I remain to this day. My need to be in the driver's seat extends to money. I could not tolerate the fact that the hard-earned funds in my 401k were at the mercy of a volatile market. Late in 2003, during the downturn that followed the dot-com bust and the events of September 11, my wife and I began investigating non-traditional ways to invest our retirement funds. Wall Street options were not cutting it, to say the least. Through readings and discussions with advisors, we learned that it was possible to invest retirement funds in your own business without having to get into debt, without tax penalties, using a self-directed 401k or rollover as business startup, as the government calls it. I only wish I had known that 8 years earlier, when I bought my first business with a seller loan. One evening at dinner, my wife and I noted how few people in our respective business circles, our community, and among our friends and family had even heard of the self-directed 401k. We felt lucky to have stumbled across the information, but it got us thinking. What if we made it our business to teach other entrepreneurs about this funding option? So, that's what we did. Eventually, Catch Fire Funding was born. Since then, we've helped thousands of Americans who have been downsized out of a job, are afraid of being let go, or pine for the freedom of entrepreneurship for a variety of other reasons. I know what it feels like to want that freedom and at the same time to be afraid of the unknowns involved in the leap from employee to entrepreneur. My record hasn't been flawless. I sold one business because it ended up being the wrong long-term fit for my skills and interests. In another instance, I broke up badly with a business partner, and a third company stayed too long in my living room with a growing staff. But I learned from all my experiences, and I was good at getting the best business advice I could afford, at striking out boldly, and at following through. All the ingredients for long-term, profitable entrepreneurship. In the pages of this book, you'll meet dozens of new entrepreneurs from across America. Former corporate warriors, public servants, or other employees who have now bought or built businesses of their own. Their ventures range from one-person companies to businesses with a large staff. They make products for or supply services to all kinds of needs in the marketplace. These once reluctant entrepreneurs range in age from their late 30s to early 60s, and they all made the leap from employee to entrepreneur midway through their careers. You can glean lots of practical advice from these entrepreneurs' stories, and from me as their business coach, including pros and cons, tips and tricks, and red flags. This book also offers useful checklists and worksheets. There's even a quiz to help you assess your state of entrepreneurial readiness. As you listen to this audiobook, I want you to think, what's my story? What makes me tick? What strength or passion am I overlooking or underestimating? Answer those questions, and you'll be ready to reinvent yourself and become the best boss you've ever had. Let's get your reinvention started. Here's to your success. Bill Seagraves, President, Catch Fire Funding, Parker, Colorado, at Catch Fire Funds. Part 1. Are you ready for a new boss? Whether you're stuck in a rut at work, recently unemployed, or hanging on to your job and sanity for dear life, you have something in common with every other person who will listen to this audiobook. You have a burning desire for something more, something better, something different and new. This burning desire, whether an ember or a full-fledged bonfire, is all you need to keep your mind open throughout this first section. I promise there will be something everyone can relate to, and that you're ready to hear it. Chapter 1. The American Dream Gone Awry. I awoke racked with thirst, with a terrible crick in my neck and aching knees. Economy class had never been kind to my 6'4" frame. Flying high above the dark abyss of a nameless city in who knows what time zone, I tried to picture what my wife and kids were doing while I was on the road. Again. Soon I'd be catching up on family stories, but I wouldn't be home long enough to join in on new adventures. But hey, I had a source of steady income to keep my family fed and housed and to finance some of our kids' dreams. A boss who sort of liked me, and I was making half-decent use of my skills and education. I was living the American dream, or at least the dream my parents raised me to believe in. Or was I? As a company man, I found I was increasingly talking myself off the ledge. My mental checklist went something like this. Comfortable? Check. Respected? Most of the time. In control? Nope. Confident about retirement? Not really. Satisfied? Yeah. Happy? In the grand scheme of life, weren't those last couple of things the most important? And in control? I felt trapped by the lifestyle I'd created for myself and my family, knowing that at the whim of my boss or under the guise of downsizing, it could all be gone in an instant. The high-priced Silicon Valley home, private daycare, a master's degree for my wife, family vacations. I was certainly not holding my own hand of cards in life. Even if I stayed in the company's good graces, the best-case scenario was that in 8 or 10 years, I could have my boss's job, which I really didn't want. And then what? What if, I thought with real horror, I became unrecognizably removed from what I'd once set out to be? Before I could stop it, I was flooded by memories of my impassioned words to my friends back in my college days about the ideas and goals that excited me. There were paths I'd never taken that I still cared about. To block out these thoughts, I stuck in my earphones and frantically flicked through the radio stations on the airplane's armrest, hoping the music would stuff down the rising lump of depression and anxiety inside me. There had to be a way out. No matter how good this career looked on the outside, I needed to find out how to make my professional life feel good on the inside, too. That scary 12-letter word. As it turned out, my route to personal happiness and financial success was to become an entrepreneur. To many people, that 12-letter word sounds lofty and alien. But even though its linguistic roots are French, entrepreneur does not translate to fear of failure in English. In fact, entrepreneur was originally a workday word that simply meant someone who undertakes a task. Or to put it in American, someone who likes to get her done. There are all kinds of entrepreneurs out there, but what they have in common is that they don't want to work for a cold, uncaring organization, but for someone who gives a damn. To that end, they realize that they themselves are the best boss they'll ever have. Getting the boot. Maybe you've been given your marching papers after years of loyalty and hard work for a faceless corporation that's decided it no longer needs or wants you. We all know lots of people whose lives have been turned upside down since the 2008 recession. You might be one of them. You may be feeling, for the first time in your life, like you're disposable. That's not a nice feeling. All of a sudden, you've gone from being a smart, successful, respected professional to, cue inner voice, a nobody, worth nothing in today's workforce. Through the up-close and personal lens of your loss, you may not be able to see the big picture behind your midlife career crash. And that picture is the baby boom's mega demographic wave. The workplace system of yesteryear that gave tenured workers, like your parents and their parents, steady raises and good benefits, eventually providing for a comfortable retirement, is no longer sustainable. There are just too many boomers for this model to continue working. A lucky few employees made it out of the recent recession, relatively unscathed. Then there are the rest of us. And even if you did survive the gory years, you may now be watching your employer shift focus to recruiting and retaining younger workers. Mid-career professionals like yourself are getting passed up for promotions and raises or forced into early retirement. It's not personal. This kind of ageism exists entirely because younger people cost less to employ. In the HR column of the ledger, you've become a liability, despite being an asset with regard to experience, skills, and maturity. It's not personal, it's business. Sure, it hurts to be overlooked, but the bottom line is that the bottom line is the only benchmark that matters in the workplace. Dan Murphy, 59, of Syracuse, New York, experienced this on both ends. He said, "As senior operations officer, every year I was challenged to do more with less, pushed to decrease the headcount. I pulled the trigger and did downsizing throughout my career. Then the gun got turned around and pointed at him. My employers felt I had gotten to a point where I was too old and too expensive, says Dan. It was easier to pay 3 20-somethings, half my salary, and let them work their calves off. He moved on, albeit reluctantly, and started his own business after almost 2 years of fruitlessly seeking a new corporate gig. Don Rollins, 62, also knows what it's like to be overlooked as too old. When his employer merged with two other arms manufacturers, the result of government sequestering, Don learned he'd have to move to New York or the Midwest. He didn't want to leave his native Florida, so he gave up his job as director of operations and did what all corporate lawyers do, started interviewing, he says. It didn't go so well. They saw my gray hair and read my resume with my 30 years experience. Then I'd go to the interview, and I could feel them thinking, how much runway does this guy have left? Don's age turned out to be a blessing in disguise. He started his own business in Sarasota, Florida, a Sign World franchise, and he's happy he did. I sure as hell don't miss the corporate world, he says. What are your options, really? Maybe you're not convinced that entrepreneurship is the answer. Maybe you're obsessing about how to fit yourself back into the corporate puzzle, even if it's an awkward fit, at least it's what you know. But the fact is, the career landscape has changed. You've changed, certainly in the eyes of employers. It's highly unlikely you'll ever come across a job ad that reads like it fits you. Seeking midlife employee with high salary demands and possibly outdated skill set. Likely to be disgruntled and in urgent need of replacement income due to family demands. Potentially overqualified and therefore likely to leave the minute something better comes along. Julie Richter was the epitome of the disgruntled employee when she decided, at age 50, that she could make something better come along, by herself. The Missoula, Montana native was pretty jaded after many years as an employee in the insurance industry. There are a lot of shenanigans and agents who only care about making the sale, she explains. I considered getting out of the business entirely. Julie especially didn't want to work for a company anymore. Versus working for the clients, which is more important, she said. She solved her crisis of conscience by starting her own insurance company with her own clients to care for. Not that it was easy. Julie admits, I was afraid to leave a salaried steady income and step into the unknown. She has that in common with a lot of mid-career entrepreneurs, like Dan Murphy, who says, it was scary. I had never been self-employed. I'd always worked for large corporations. Never in a million years did I think I'd start my own business. While Julie chose to get off the corporate train, Dan was escorted off due to downsizing. He had been managing up to 250 people at a major financial services institution, and at first he wanted back into the corporate puzzle so badly, I was even at the point that I was willing to relocate again, he says. But my age and income level scared new opportunities away. The same reasons for my downsizing in the first place. Are your golden years losing their luster? What is going to change now or in the future that will give you enough of an income bump to make a real difference for your retirement dreams? A series of large raises or promotions? Stock options? A lottery win? You've been working your butt off for the man for years. And who gets a new yacht? Or a winter home in Florida? Not you. The top executives and shareholders at your company don't need to wait until they retire to get those perks. They enjoy them now, courtesy of all your hard work. How is your own retirement shaping up? Are you on track to get the golden years you've been dreaming of, or is the gold losing its luster? It's possible in this day and age that you could end up being forced into early retirement by your employer. Is your nest egg big enough to cover your desired retirement? Retired, but inspired. Even if you are already comfortably retired, you may be driving yourself and your spouse crazy with too much time on your hands. After all, there are only so many things you can fix around the house. Maybe you miss giving back to your community. Or it's possible that retirement is costing more than you anticipated, and you aren't sure how many more years of quality retirement you can afford. In any of these cases, entrepreneurship could be an attractive option. You're not ready to be put out to pasture, physically and or financially. You may be retired, but you're still inspired to make a buck. Keeping your roots. It's a common scenario in this day and age of mergers and acquisitions for employees to be asked to uproot their families and relocate out of state, or even out of the United States, to accommodate a company's change in ownership. But you might be reluctant to move your spouse from a good job, and your kids away from school and friends, or maybe you don't want to be too far away from your aging parents. In any case, relocation by your employer may not be a viable solution for you. Mike Pred, a global vice president at a leading healthcare corporation, was given an ultimatum. He could relocate out of state or lose his job. He and his wife decided not to pick up and move their daughter during her high school years. Mike looked around at other work options and concluded I could eventually replace my income with a Pride Staff franchise while building an asset that could achieve a rate of return that would exceed what I could get in passive investments like the stock market, he told us. He made the decision to leave the corporate world in November 2013. I have not looked back, he says. Don Rollins faced the same kind of relocate or you're out choice from his corporate employer. In his case, the kids were all grown and on their own, but still, Don and his wife didn't want to leave their native Florida. What Don does now, building signs for his franchise, is certainly different from being an engineer at an arms manufacturer. But, in his words, I still get to build stuff. And he doesn't have to give up his daily contact with other people, something Don admits he just could not envision for himself, despite being, at 62, close to the old-school retirement age. Visiting customers, working alongside his employee, chatting with other local business people in the region where he lives and works, that is Don's lifeline. If not now, when? Even if you're still employed, you may see that you're running out of road. Your company is letting your colleagues go, one painful batch at a time, and you suspect that your number is coming up. Like a deli ticket from hell, the waiting game is as bad as, if not worse than, actually receiving the pink slip. Maybe you're stuck in a job you no longer enjoy and you're pining for a change. You're the one who tells family and friends at each Christmas party, "This is the year I'm going to make the jump and be my own boss." And then nothing changes. Sure, change can be scary, but feeling stuck is worse. Or maybe you're not looking forward to a passive retirement. Many baby boomers aren't as comfortable with that as previous generations were. Dave Young, 49, of Jackson, Missouri, says bluntly, "I'm not a big fan of saving your retirement funds to use when you're old, which aren't your best years." Dave is using that retirement money now, injecting it into his dream business, which is a startup kennel and breeder. About his own reinvention from employee to entrepreneur, Tom McCary says, "Sometimes it's just put up or shut up time." In 2012, Tom applied for a job as police chief in Cripple Creek, Colorado, an historic gold rush town on the southwest slopes of Pikes Peak in the Rockies. He and his wife, Patty, stayed at the area's KOA campground, and Tom recalls, "We half joked that if the Cripple Creek KOA ever came up for sale, we should look into buying it." He didn't get the police chief job, and they went home. Then, in June 2013, the Cripple Creek KOA came on the market. It was go time for the McCarys. They put their money where their mouths were and bought the KOA business. Even if you're younger and nowhere near retirement, you may have had an epiphany like mine, where you realize you're not chasing the dreams of your younger self and you can't see any good reason why not. Andrew Kaplinger, 35. Went the corporate route for 15 years until he had a New Year's Eve talk with his wife, Courtney, about where he was headed. He made a pact that by a year from that date, he would have launched his dream business. He followed through, and Kaplinger's fresh, Catch Seafood Market was born in Indianapolis. I've known I've wanted to do this since I was a junior in high school, says Andrew. We were a bunch of business dorks in the marketing club. I was part of different competitions at the national level. At one, I had to write a business plan and present it to SBA loan officers. My idea was a fish market and restaurant combined. I won at the state level. Andrew will tell you how good it feels to live up to the boy wonder he was 20 years before, and that all the work to become that entrepreneur has been worth it. Life changers. Then there are life-changing moments that remind us how short our time is on Earth, both for us and our loved ones. These experiences can really show us what's important in life, and they may push us to embrace change now, rather than put it off anymore. Pete Daly, 49, had a life-changing experience involving his father that helped him make the decision to leave his long corporate career as a meteorologist in 2014 and pursue his dream, which was a startup restaurant in Oakland, California. Dad and I sat and talked, just the two of us, in my apartment. It was the first time we'd ever talked about me changing my career, says Pete. Dad recommended that I do what makes me happy. A couple of weeks later, his father died suddenly in his sleep. Pete was ready to make the leap to entrepreneurship. Or it could be your own mortality that gives your entrepreneurial dreams a jumpstart. A serious health issue had Mark Olnick reviewing his priorities and looking more closely at his next chapter. Getting a pacemaker at age 43 will do that, he says. Now 51, Mark is going after his dream of starting a pickle company with his wife in Pennsylvania, instead of putting it off for someday. Life changers can also include new relationships or a point in a long-term relationship where a couple reevaluates how much time they spend together. Michael Croteau can relate to the former.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.